We know how to do energy balance pretty well by now, I hope. So now we're moving on to entropy balance. Entropy balance is a bit different compared to energy balance because entropy change is almost always greater than the entropy transfer to a system, since entropy is generated during a process. If we have a system like this, we have some entropy entering the system, then we have some leaving the system, but we also have entropy generated through the process of the system. That's the key difference with entropy balance. Remember that with energy balance, we just had energy in and energy out, and that gave us the change in energy of the system. But again, for entropy balance, we have entropy entering, entropy leaving, and entropy generated within the system, and all of that gives us the change in total entropy of the system. We can write that like this. Now, how does entropy transfer into and out of a system? There are just two ways entropy is transferred to a system. The first is heat transfer, and the other is mass flow. That's it. That means if you have a closed system, then the only entropy transfer that can happen is through heat, not work or anything else, just heat. In other words, if your system is closed and adiabatic, meaning no heat transfer, then entropy transfer is zero. So when heat is transferred to a system, this heat brings in molecular disorganization, which we call entropy. The equation to find it is this. Here, Q is the heat transfer, and T is the absolute temperature at the location where the transfer takes place. In simple terms, if heat is transferred to the system, entropy is transferred to the system, and if heat is transferred out of the system, then entropy is also transferred out of the system. We can write this in rate form, so with a dot on top like this. Make sure to remember that work does not create entropy transfer. However, it's possible that work might create friction or other less useful forms of energy which can create entropy through heat. Now on to the second method of entropy transfer, which is mass flow. If we have a system where mass can cross into and out of the system, then that brings along entropy. If the mass of a system doubles, then entropy of the system also doubles. We can figure out entropy transfer by mass flow using this equation. Here, m is mass, and s is specific entropy, in other words, entropy per unit mass. This can also be written in rate form like this. Now that we have an idea of how entropy transfers in and out of a system, let's go back to our entropy balance equation. So this part here is the net entropy transfer by heat or mass. This is the entropy that's generated through the process within the system, and when we add it all together, we get the change in entropy. The units are these. This equation can also be written in rate form. Then the units would be these. We can also write it per unit mass basis, so with lowercase letters, and the units would be these. Keep in mind that if the process is reversible, then there is no entropy generated, so this part gets eliminated. Also, if our system was a steady flow system, then the change in entropy for the whole system becomes zero. Most of the time, when solving problems, your goal is to figure out the entropy generated during a process. So that's this term right here. You will need to remember how to find entropy when it comes to ideal gases, incompressible substances, and more. So if you need a refresh on those topics, I highly encourage you to watch those videos before heading into equations dealing with entropy balance. All of this will make more sense with examples, so let's get to it. Let's take a look at this question, where nitrogen is compressed adiabatically, and we need to figure out the entropy generation per unit mass. We can start by writing down what we know. The initial pressure of the nitrogen is 100 kilopascals at a temperature of 25 degrees Celsius, and the final pressure is 600 kilopascals at a temperature of 290 degrees Celsius. Now we need to write an entropy balance equation in rate form. Since there is no heat transfer, the only form of entropy transfer is through mass flow. In simple terms, we have nitrogen entering our system and then leaving on the other side, transferring entropy during that process. Remember that this is a steady flow system, So the rate of entropy change is zero for this process. Let's isolate this equation for the entropy generated. Now we can divide both sides by mass flow since the question wants the answer per unit mass. Well, this part is just the change in entropy, and we can find that using this equation since we have both pressure and temperature values. This should be familiar to you from the entropy change of ideal gases. If you need a refresh, please watch that video first. We have everything we need except for the constant specific pressure value and the gas constant of nitrogen. We can find these from a table, but first, we need to figure out the average temperature of the system. Let's add initial and final temperatures together and divide it by 2. Remember, we need to find the average temperature for the constant specific pressure value when we use this equation. Now using this value, we can get the Cp value. So looking at our table, our Cp value should be somewhere between these two values. Extrapolating gives us a value of 1.047. If you'd like a refresh on how to extrapolate these values, please take a look at the description where I've shown the steps. The R value can be found from a table like this. Now that we have all of these values, let's plug them in and solve. And that's our answer. Let's take a look at this problem where we have a heat exchanger heating up water using geothermal water. We need to find the rate of heat transfer and the rate of entropy generation. Let's start by writing down what we know. The water that's to be heated must go from 25 to 60 degrees Celsius at a rate of 0.5 kilograms per second. We're given the constant pressure specific heat for the water as well. The geothermal water is at a temperature of 140 degrees Celsius and flows at a rate of 0.75 kilograms per second. The specific heat value for that is also given. First, we can figure out the rate of heat transfer. For that, let's write an energy balance equation with the cold water pipe as our system. Energy in minus energy out gives us the change in energy of the system. Since this is a steady flow system, the rate of energy change for our system is zero. Let's bring the energy out to the other side. Now thinking back to heat exchangers, what energy goes in and what energy goes out? Remember, our system is the cold water pipe. So we have heat input, so that's the heat that's going into the cold water from the hot geothermal water. Then we have just mass flow and enthalpy. On the other side, we have only mass flow and enthalpy. The mass flows are the same because it's a single inlet and outlet. This should be familiar to you from the video about heat exchangers. If you need a refresh, I highly encourage you to take a look at that video first. Now we can isolate for heat input. Let's factor out the mass flow so we can get H2 minus H1, which gives us a difference in enthalpy. We can use this equation to figure out the difference in enthalpy, so let's plug that in as well. Now we can plug in our values and solve for the heat input. That gives us the heat transfer for the cold water. The next step wants us to figure out the rate of entropy generated, which means we will need to know the temperature of the geothermal water after it loses some of its heat to the cold water. So let's do that before going to the next step. So now we take the geothermal pipe as our system. So let's write another energy balance equation. For energy in, we just have mass flow and enthalpy, and for energy out, in addition to the mass flow and enthalpy, we have heat output. This is the heat transferred from the hot water to the cold water pipe. Let's isolate this equation for the heat output. As before, let's factor out the mass flow. Now we can replace H1 minus H2. Keep in mind that the heat output is the same as the heat input to the cold water pipe. With that in mind, we can plug in all of our values to get the temperature of the geothermal water after some heat is transferred. Solving tells us the final temperature of the geothermal water. So it went from 140 degrees Celsius to 117.4 degrees Celsius. Now let's go and figure out the entropy generation. We can write an entropy balance equation, and now we have to consider the whole heat exchanger. When we consider this whole heat exchanger as our system, keep in mind that there is no heat transfer from or to the system from the surroundings. So for the water pipe, we have mass flow in and mass flow out. And then for the geothermal water pipe, we have mass flow in and mass flow out. Then we have the entropy generated, and all of that is equal to the change in entropy of the system. But it's a steady flow system, so it's zero. Let's isolate this equation for entropy generated and factor out the mass flows. So how can we solve this equation? Remember that both the water and the geothermal water are incompressible substances. So you have to think back to the video about entropy change of solids and liquids. We can use this equation to figure out our values. If you need a refresh, please see that video. We will tackle each part separately and then add it together at the end. So first, the water. Let's plug our values in and solve. Next, the geothermal water. Remember to use the final temperature of the geothermal water we found earlier. Let's solve. The total entropy generated is the addition of these two values. This is also equal to kilowatts per Kelvin, and those are our answers. Let's take a look at this problem where we have steam expanding in a turbine steadily. We need to figure out the entropy generated. We can start by writing down what we know. The steam expands at a rate of 40,000 kilograms per hour, or 11.11 kilograms per second. The steam enters with a pressure of 8 megapascals at 500 degrees Celsius and leaves with a pressure of 40 kilopascals as a saturated vapor. The turbine produces 8.2 megawatts of power. We are given the temperature of the surroundings, which is 25 degrees Celsius, so we need to consider that when we figure out the entropy generation. To figure out the entropy generated, we can write an entropy balance equation. We have mass flow coming in and then leaving, and we also have some heat transfer to the surroundings. Since this is a steady flow system, the change of entropy is zero. Keep in mind that mass flow is the same at the inlet and outlet, since there is only one inlet and one outlet. Looking at this equation, we need to figure out S1, S2, and Q. We can easily figure out the entropy values from steam tables. For S1, we have a pressure of 8 megapascals and a temperature of 500 degrees Celsius. Here is the entropy value we need. For S2, the pressure is 40 kilopascals, and we're told it's a saturated vapor now, so here is the entropy value we need. The last thing we need is the heat output. To figure that out, we need to write an energy balance equation. For a steady flow turbine, we have energy in is equal to energy out. Now what energy goes in? It's just mass flow and enthalpy. And what energy goes out? We have mass flow and enthalpy going out, we also have power generated by the turbine, and we need to consider the heat loss to the surroundings. Since we aren't given anything about the velocity of the steam, we will consider the change of velocity to be negligible. If this is unfamiliar to you, please watch the video about turbines. To solve for heat loss, we need to figure out H1 and H2. So let's go back to our steam tables and look for these values. The initial pressure is 8 megapascals, and the temperature is 500 degrees Celsius. So here is our initial enthalpy. For final enthalpy, remember the pressure is 40 kilopascals, and the steam is now a saturated vapor. Now that we have these values, we can plug them into our energy balance equation to solve for heat loss. Keep in mind that 8.2 megawatts is equal to 8,200 kilojoules per second. Solving gives us our heat transfer. Now that we have the heat loss to the surroundings, we can go back to our entropy equation and plug it in. Solving gives us our answer. That should cover the types of problems you will face when it comes to entropy balance. Thanks for watching, and best of luck with your studies.